Natural Resources, Infrastructure and Industrial Capabilities, Part 2. I would request Ms. Soe Myint to chair this session, please.
Thank you. And I'm very honored to be chair for this last session of today. In this last session, there will be two speakers. The first speaker, Mr. Soe Myint, Soe Myint will talk about energy sector in Myanmar. And the second speaker, Professor Kudo, will talk about industrial development in Myanmar. First of all, but before I invite the speaker, I would like to thank Professor Kudo that he contributes a lot to Myanmar Research Society. When I study in Chiang Mai University, me as well as my friends are actually relying on Professor Kudo's paper. So thank you very much. So may I invite the first speaker, Soe Myint. Soe Myint joined the government service as a geologist in 1962. And he rose to become Director General of Energy Planning Department of the Ministry of Energy in 1995. And he headed the Energy Planning Department and was responsible as technical and policy arm of the ministry for 13 years until 2008 when he retired. He is still active in his private life as a speaker on Myanmar energy sector in various conferences in the region as well as within the country. So the floor is yours, Mr. Soe Myint.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairman, for introducing me to the audience. And also, I want to express my thanks to all the people who have been sitting all the day today, listening to all the topics that you may want to know and you may not want to know. But at the same time, I hope I'll be able to activate you to something level so that you cannot, you cannot go to sleep. I'm very much honored to talk about this energy sector in Myanmar to NIAS, National Institute for Advanced Studies. Myanmar and India has been so close and so near. Myanmar is actually influenced by being near to India as well as to China. As Excellency Ambassador already told you this morning, if you happen to have seen a Myanmar gentleman with a jacket and a longi, jacket we copy from China, Chinese. Longi we copy from India, Indian people. So without those influences, I'm not quite sure what we would be doing without any jacket and without any longi. Another point which is quite noteworthy is, you know, even though Myanmar, about 51 million people, is sandwiched between two largest countries, China, the largest communist economy to the east, India, the largest democracy country in the west, we'll be able to maintain our cultural identity, we'll be able to maintain our political identity up to now. And we take pride in that for being able to survive within those two large countries. But in the future, I'll be talking to you in the later part of the presentation, how we are going to take advantage of those two big countries who would eventually become the highest economic country in 2050. Myanmar, you may know, or you may be misled by people that Myanmar is a rich country. Yes, It's true, it's a rich country, but the people there are very, very poor. Myanmar consumes only about 17,000 barrels of oil a day, while our neighbor in the east, a small neighbor, Thailand, is consuming something like 1.2 million barrels of oil per day. And for your information, India is consuming about 3.8 or let's say about 4 million barrels a day. At the same time, Myanmar is consuming less than 300 million cubic feet of natural gas, while we are exporting so much of natural gas to China and Thailand. In terms of electric power, Myanmar is very much consuming very much lower than India or Thailand. We are consuming only about 250 kilowatt hour per capita per year. It is still feeling a little bit uneasy for us. A country like India, with the population of something like 1.3 billion people, can manage to have a sizable amount of electric energy for everybody. Myanmar is only consuming 300 kilowatt-hour a year per person. And the electrification rate, you may be surprised to know, is only 30%. This is a picture taken from a satellite, a night picture, many years ago. The one on the top is a picture taken in 1992 of Myanmar, Bangladesh, and Thailand. And the picture below is a picture taken during 2010 for the same countries. You can see Bangladesh if is improving, so is Thailand. But Myanmar has only one bright spot in the middle of the country, Naypyidaw. You can see how much we are lagging behind, even though we are led to understand that we are quite rich in the natural resources. Myanmar is, as I said earlier, supposedly rich in natural energy resources. We are exporting 1.2 to 1.5 billion cubic feet of natural gas a day to Thailand and China. And Myanmar is exporting about 500 megawatt of electricity to China. Yet, Myanmar is one of the lowest commercial energy consumers in this part of the world. In terms of oil and gas richness, Myanmar is endowed with 16 geological provinces onshore and 4 sedimentary geological provinces offshore. When I talk about geological provinces, you may be a little bit confused. In the petroleum geology, the subject that we use in the search for petroleum, oil and gas, we always call the geological regime, which is a basin-like, to be potential for commercial accumulation of hydrocarbon. That's why we say geological provinces in the offshore and the onshore. And all these geological provinces, 16 in the onshore, 4 in the offshore, are still very poorly explored. If we have people like Geological Survey of India, ONGC, Reliance, Oil India Limited, and so forth, Myanmar would be discovering lots and lots of new oil and gas accumulation. The reason I'm saying that, even though India is very much thoroughly explored, the Khan Energy of India managed to find MBA in Rajasthan, a 5 billion barrels capacity oil field. So if that sort of a technology, funding, and people will come to work to Myanmar, we still have so many chances of discovering new accumulation. Let's talk about hydropower. The World Bank study in 1995, it says that Myanmar could have a potential of something like 100,800 megawatt of potential installed capacity in Myanmar. Myanmar, because it has highlands in the middle, in the west, and in the east, and all the Himalayan mountains melting away their glaciers, ice, and the Salun River coming from Tibetan land. So we have all these hydropower sources amounting to something like 100,800 megawatt. Out of that, we have managed to investigate about 46,000 megawatt of potential hydropower projects. And out of 46,000 megawatt, our own hydropower installation is only about 3,000 megawatt only, less than 6% of the investigated potential hydropower electricity. Currently, we are utilizing mainly hydropower and natural gas. We still need to identify an appropriate generation mix like India, like any other countries in this part of the world. We're still having some problem to identify the appropriate generation mix. Let's talk about the political context, okay? We have a new government led by U Thein Sein since 2011 March. And the government, from the very beginning, it proclaimed that they are going for democratic state. And they work out some documents, which is called National Comprehensive Development Plan and the FESR, the Framework for Economic and Social Reform. Based on those two documents, they run a series of reforms in politics, economy, and governance. Because of all the activities carried out by the government of U Thein Sein, the World Bank report in 2012 noted that Myanmar is going through a triple transition. You may know already, but just to impress you more, okay? One transition is from military to democracy. Myanmar has been under military rule since 1962, 14 years after the independence in 1948. We are also aiming to go through conflict to peace. We have as many as 135 different tribes going on their own way, having something like 17 armed groups in the country. So we're going to make some sort of peace with them, and we have some successes, and the news are in the air that we're going to sign an agreement to stop fighting among ourselves. The third transition we've been trying to go through is central planning to market economy. That has been already in the process now. We have already made some significant advances until May 2015. We have already accomplished and established a culture of negotiation between the fighting groups. We have managed to maintain a peace talks with the ethnic armed groups. We have also re-engaged with the international community. We have also been planning to construct special economic zones. We have been trying to accomplish connectivity among the region, and we have also been able to improve our economic performances. Yet, we found that the advances so far made by the current government is good. And some people say that it can be something like verging on the miraculous feet. I think most of the speakers have already talked this morning and they agree that the government has done something quite good, quite significant. But the challenges are still ahead. Most pressing and highly uncertain challenges are, number one, 2015, 8 November general election. Of course, the government has been trying to reassure again and again and again that it's going to be a fair election. They are not going back to previous type of regime. Yet, people are still sort of uneasy how the new general election will take place and what will be the result. And the second issue, or maybe one of the issues, is the migrant issue. I put it very, very softly here. I want to avoid the Rohingya issue. Another thing is corruption, which is also plaguing the country for so many years and still going on. And the poverty, the gap of poverty gap between rural people and urban people are very, very huge. Without managing to narrow down that gap, Myanmar will not be doing well. But even in those in this situation, all of the multilateral organizations like World Bank, Asian Development Bank, and also another private consulting firm, McKinsey Global Institute, they have a good prediction of how Myanmar would be in the future. World Bank says that Myanmar's average GDP could be something like 8.5% for the years to come until 2020. Asian Development Bank says that Myanmar would become a middle-income country by 2030. McKinsey Global Institute predicts that Myanmar should be earning 4 times the GDP of the current earning by 2030, attaining the status of a middle-income country. And all these projections made in 2012 has been reinforced again by 2014. The World Bank, in their latest report on Myanmar issued in August 2014, says that and also another one in January 2015, and IMF, they all say that Myanmar's economy is growing and its engagement with the world's economy is catching up. The updates further stated that Myanmar's medium to long-term economic prospects remain strong. So the projection made about 4 years ago and the recent update in 2014-15 indicate that multilateral organizations like IMF, World Bank, they have a very high opinion on how Myanmar would be faring in the near future. For all these to happen, let's see what are happening in the energy sector, in oil and natural gas sector. The oil and natural gas sector has been a very important foreign currency earner in the recent past. Amidst the heavy sanctions imposed by U.S. government and EU, you may not know how Myanmar has to try very hard to survive in all these years, from 1990 until about 2010. Our own earning, justifiable earning, made from export of natural gas, we cannot bring it home to Myanmar in terms of US dollar. We have to change to other currency and then only bring it to Myanmar. But we managed to survive. In fact, the oil and gas sector has also helped the country to gain face among the energy-hungry neighboring countries during the difficult years of Myanmar from 1990s until 2010. Okay? Currently, Myanmar is exporting natural gas to Thailand and China through 4 cross-border pipelines. Myanmar is also a transit country and a host country partner to 1 cross-border crude oil pipeline with a capacity of transporting 500,000 barrels a day of Middle East crude, while from Middle East to China through Myanmar. At the same time, Myanmar is working with several other international companies with 60 production sharing contracts involving 35 companies from 20 countries, including Shell, Total, BG, Woodside, Statoil, ConocoPhillips, Eni from Italy, and ONGC Bidash from India. In the electric power sector, of course, I have reported to you that Myanmar's electrification is only about 30%, with the per capita consumption only about 300 kilowatt hour. It's now working with the World Bank to upgrade the electric power situation, targeting to improve from current 30% rate to 100% by 2030 with the assistance of the World Bank. The World Bank is coming up with National Electrification Plan, NEP, for Myanmar with an estimated capital requirement of more than $12 billion. They hope to accomplish this very tough job by 2030. At the same time, Japan is working on the National Electricity Master Plan to fulfill the targets of World Bank. And at the same time, Asian Development Bank is working on an energy master plan for Myanmar, enlisting optimal fuel demand scenarios, which would be required to achieve the perceived economic development. And we have also recently issued the electric power law, electricity law 2014. Before, electric power sector is the total responsibility of the Ministry of Electric Power. Now, it opens up to private sector by way of independent power productions, joint venture, captive power production, and private-public partnership. Yet, we are facing still lots of problems and issues, some for the long term and some for the immediate future. For instance, we have been exporting natural gas for the last 20 years since 1998. We're now thinking whether we should be pursuing that policy in the years to come, or shall we use it within Myanmar? And the second issue, we know we are rich in hydropower resources. For the future generation mix, should we be exploiting more of hydropower than any other fuel like natural gas or coal? And for the future gas users, we know we can earn easy money from export of natural gas. But what if we use it domestically for our own industry? And also worrying that we have a very large gap between urban and rural electricity we supply, should we be emphasizing more on the rural electrification than on the urban centered power generation plant? And for the more immediate issues, we have a very ancient I believe you are interested to hear my dogs, okay? So I'm not stopping, even though there are some sort of reputation. I'll keep on talking, okay? I was here in New Delhi about 2 months ago, attending an 50th anniversary of ONGC. At that time, there were some people from the international energy industries coming over to celebrate the occasion. At this celebration, the Minister of Electric Power was telling that India would be going on to use more electric power to meet the rising demand of electric power. And those people from the international community, international energy community, pointed out that no, coal is not good for carbon emission. You better be thinking about that. And Minister of Electric Power rebutted back that you people has been using coal for the last 100 years or more, since the Industrial Revolution. And now you are telling us not to use coal. What is your, is it a fire opinion? And so those people keep quiet now. So likewise, people like Myanmar country, we should be not hesitant to use coal even as a stopgap measure. Of course, as we get richer, then we can move on to other cleaner fuel, okay? And in the regional cooperation program, Myanmar is very active in the ASEAN, GMS, CLMV, AGMEX, BIMSTEC, BASEM, and SAARC. We are already committed to ASEAN Power Grid, with the power line stretching from Indonesia through Malaysia and Singapore to Thailand. And eventually it will go to China also. And we have ASEAN gas pipeline, Trans-ASEAN gas pipeline, TAGB. Already a pipeline existing between Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, and Myanmar. A few years ago, when I was the chairman of the BIMSTEC Energy Expert Group, we even talked about Trans-BIMSTEC gas pipeline, exporting gas from Myanmar through Bangladesh to India. We thought it would materialize, but you know, I don't want to repeat that sad story again, okay? It never realized up to now. And we have also established the, what we call intergovernmental agreement and the RBTA, Regional Power Trading Agreement, among the GMS region to transport and transmit the electric power among the member countries. And for Myanmar, as our own policy, we have already established what we call National Energy Management Committee to coordinate all the energy-related matters under the same roof. We have as many as 8 ministries looking after different aspects of the energy sector. So we try to sort of consolidate and try to move more effectively than before. And also, we have formulated the national energy policy with emphasis on the supply capability improvement, also not forgetting the demand side management, technology, and international collaboration. Myanmar is currently in the process of formulating an energy security strategy. As I said earlier, we are rich in natural resources, but we are still poor in trying to exploit the natural resources. For all these things to happen, and also to meet our commitment to our regional neighbors, we are in the process of drawing up an energy security plan. And this is going to be a very tough job of Myanmar to meet the requirement of the country as well as to meet the requirement of the regional neighbors like China, India, and Thailand. So this is it's going to be a very short run through, okay? This is what is going to happen in 2050. China is going to be the top earner of GDP, followed by India, Japan, and Korea by 2050. So definitely this century is going to be an Asian century with all the rich countries like China, India, Japan, Korea coming up in the near future. So with all this development in the neighboring countries, Myanmar definitely is sure to enjoy the, let's say, trickle-down economy. This is the blocks that we have demarcated, and we have recently awarded a few deep water blocks and the shallow water blocks. And this is the Trans-ASEAN gas pipeline extending from Indonesia all the way to Myanmar, okay? Now, I'm trying to show this thing. This thing happened in reality, practically. What we have been talking in the BIMSTEC and SAGES is just a dream up to now. But later in the future, this must come into place. This is the pipeline that Myanmar has been operating in the recent past. Jelena exporting gas to Thailand, Yadagon also to Thailand, Sotiga came to Thailand, Shue, we are going to supply to China, okay? And China gas pipeline and also the oil pipeline. Altogether, we have as many as 6 cross-border pipeline now. This is the pipeline that has been running across Myanmar. And this is the ASEAN power grid, all the way from Indonesia and to Myanmar to Tasan, eventually to China again. This is the planned power projects. We have talked about Tamandi, and we have talked about Shui Saye to work with the Indian government. But up to now, it did not take place yet. But in the future, we hope to catch it up again. These are the export projects that were being contemplated in the recent past. These are the SEZ which we've been doing right now, the where, together with Japan, Korea, Thailand. In fact, SEZ, the West SEZ zone is a project that was first formulated between India and Myanmar in one of the BIMSTEC meetings. Because I was there at the meeting, the where deep sea port, or the where SEZ is one formulated by India and Myanmar. And Tilawa, very near to Yangon, and also Chao Phu, together with the Kelantan River development projects. So these are going to be a very important gateway between India and Myanmar, eventually. So in conclusion, you may want to know that OVL, ONGC, VDESH, and GAIL, they are already owning a sizable percentage of share in the revenue-producing Shui project. And that project is already earning a few billion dollars a year. And you are already owning total about 26%. You are already fetching the profits from Myanmar now. Likewise, from the gas pipeline, you are already fetching something like 13% of the profits from Myanmar to India. And currently, OVL, Reliance, Oil India, they are looking for petroleum in the offshore blocks. And Tata Group, they are already discussing with the Myanmar government for construction of a coal-fired power plant, about 1,200 megawatt. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for bearing with me. Thank you.